I'm not going to tell you what climate change is. I assume and trust that everyone in this audience knows what climate change is. We see a 900-year drought in the Middle East. We see floods in the UK. We see families suffering in both cases. We see our energy landscapes changing. I just took the train down from Edinburgh and I could see solar panels, wind turbines. It looks different. And we also see the strains that are starting to be put on governments, institutions, and companies as they start to disentangle this challenging relationship they have with the fossil fuel sector. But what I am going to tell you a story about is a story of myself and how I am finding a way to tackle climate change. So, people always ask me, what was the first action you did? What was your first climate action? And I always think about this, and I go back right to the beginning, the first time in which I got taught about climate change. So luckily for me, I was able to learn about climate change at school. So I think I was about 14, and it was in a science class, and we had a 15-minute run-through of what the carbon cycle is, what this thing called the greenhouse effect is, and that was it. And I just put up my hand, and I just said, wait a second, how, who, what? I just don't understand. And I didn't get many answers, but there was something deeply unsettling about it, and I couldn't not say something. I didn't know what I was saying, I didn't know what I was looking for, but it just didn't feel right. At this time, I also started to get a little bit of a reputation for myself. I got told I was political. I didn't know what that meant. I don't come from a particularly political family. I did go to a particularly political school. I went to a comprehensive school in a small city in southwest England. And I didn't know what it meant to be political, but I got told that, and knew there was something about climate change, which I found very challenging. So I had those two things. Then I spent a bit of time kind of being involved in various different activities, be that in organising birthday presents or for teachers, or organising theatre or plays, and lots of different things like that. And climate kept on coming up as a thing, but I never really found my home, my place to work on it. And then I went to university. I was very lucky to have gone to university. And I was in my halls, and I'm sure some of you will recognise this experience. And I was like, why are the lights on all night? It's really annoying. Why is there so much food wasted? Why are the windows so drafty? I'm cold, the food's not very nice, and I'm really fed up with that blooming light in my eyes. So I go along to my halls committee, and I say, I've got my list of complaints. Who can help with this? And what they turned around and said to me was that no one had that brief. No one had the responsibility to think about environment or climate-related issues. And this just wasn't good enough. So, unfortunately for the committee, I then said, okay, I am your brief. I am your environmental rep. And to this day, they still have an environmental rep. So that is the first lesson I wanted to share with you on my journey of finding how I can be part of tackling climate change. And this is the words of a very good friend and colleague of mine, Tom Burke. But the words are, elect yourself. So create that space and where you can do something about tackling or seizing the problem that you're trying to take hold of, when, even when it seems so big and messy. So that's my first lesson. Then my second lesson. So this was a real turning point for me. I had my opportunity to explore a little bit when I was first at university, but I still wanted more. And the turning point for me was joining an organisation called the UK Youth Climate Coalition. And this organisation is a peer-run organisation. And the hardest and best thing about UKYCC, or the UK Youth Climate Coalition, is that it's made up. That was a really hard thing to learn. Like, what do you mean it's made up? My parents would say to me, you're doing all this work for this organisation, don't you think they should be paying you, you think they should be more thankful? And I was like, this organisation is me. It is me and the people I'm working with, and we are working together to achieve things. And that meant we were able to have conversations that we wouldn't be able to have in other spaces, to be able to challenge structures of power. We were able to challenge our assumptions and do that in a safe way which was supportive to one another. And I will be ever indebted to those individuals and that opportunity for that space created for me. So my second lesson for you, or for me, was make it up. make up better, and make up together. And then I move on into my professional career, whatever that means, and I began working by this point on climate diplomacy. Again, what does climate diplomacy mean? The thing I always told my sister when she asked me this, she's much younger than me, was making the good conversations louder and the bad ones go away. If anyone has a better definition, please share it with me. It's a hard thing to explain. And so I'm working in climate diplomacy, and ahead of me is this thing called the Paris COP21. And this is the 21st Conference of the Parties, which means that all the UN countries, or the countries in the world, come together and are working on climate change. So 21, that's a lot. They happen every year, 21. And the mission to start working on this started 2 years before that, so 23 years. That's the vast majority of my life. There was a conversation every year about reaching some kind of global agreement. And this was seen as Paris is our next opportunity. It's the next big thing to work on. And we've had a really tough time a few years earlier when we'd seen a conference of the parties which took place in Copenhagen in 2009 not realise what we wanted it to realise, which was a global agreement. And that had been a big moment for people. People had really insisted and campaigned and worked incredibly hard to get that global agreement. And when we hadn't, when politicians hadn't listened, it was so defeating. So we had this moment where we had to lift people up again, and we had to really land something in that agreement that would help us to work even more on climate change. So one of the things that we really needed to achieve was the inevitability, the reality check, which it took me a long time to learn this as well, that to cap warming, to limit warming at any level, the internationally recognised level now is 1.5 degrees, previously it was 2 before Paris, but to cap warming, you have to go to 0. Obviously it makes sense, you have to stop emitting, but that's not what I learned at school, and we needed that agreement to tell that story. We also needed that agreement to say, every country is going to come back, every partner, every country, every person, every community is going to come back to the table and keep bringing more commitments and more action until we get to that zero. Because only then will we have peace that we have achieved something. The other thing that agreement needs to do is we're in a different world that we were in 23 years ago. 23 years ago, we thought we can deal with climate change before it arrives. Now, we have to deal with climate change to avoid it being worse than it is today, so cap the likelihood of chaos in the future, but we also have to deal with the chaos of the present. I talked before about flooding, I talked before about drought, and this impacting families and communities everywhere. We have to be able to do that. So I'm working on this Paris Agreement, and I'm thinking, why am I in a UN building? Why am I talking to all these elite people who work in all these big institutions? Why am I working with campaigners? Why am I working with cities? What is my role? And I suddenly realized, I had this scary dawning realization that, whoa, there's a responsibility on my shoulders. So I felt responsibility before because I had this agitation, this thing that I wanted to try and explore and to do something about. But I realized that I was part of a select group. I was part of a word which I found really scary, which was, I was part of an elite. And that really scared me, because I was always very scared of something called the elite. What I was actually really scared of, as I realized, was elitism. I was really scared that you had these assumptions and structures, and that was the only way to achieve power. But what my third lesson in engaging on climate change was, I learned that I had to take responsibility for being part of an elite, but not be elitist about it. So not wield power unnecessarily, but use my responsibility, my opportunity to work on climate change. So those are my three lessons. So we now have a situation where, like I said, we've got to cap the probability of runaway climate change, which will be incredibly difficult for all of us, and we've got to deal with the fact that impacts are going to hit us anyway. So we've got to maintain agency, we've got to support one another, we've got to be kind. We've got to do things together, we've got to have humility, and we've got to do it without ego, and we have to take responsibility. So, who am I to tackle climate change? I'm a daughter, I'm a sister, I'm a partner, I'm a friend, I'm an EU citizen, which I will definitely put out there, and I'm a person, I'm a human being that understood, that agitated, that found people to work together with. And my question to you is, who are you to tackle climate change? What can your role be? Thank you.